شكرا دكتور مصطفى. يعني طبعا بشكر دكتور مجدي على دعوتي النهارده في الايفنت ده. هي اتس برستيجيوس ايفنت. ماي برزنتيشن از اباوت اوبتيمال ميديكال تريتمنت فور كرونيك كورونري سيندرومز. You know that the latest guidelines that was published 2 months ago changed the name of chronic stable angina to chronic coronary syndromes and identified 6 common scenarios for these syndromes. The first one are patients with suspected coronary artery disease and stable anginal symptoms and or dyspnea. The second one are patients with new onset of heart failure or left ventricular dysfunction and suspected coronary artery disease. The third scenario are patients with stabilized symptoms less than 1 year after acute coronary syndromes or after revascularization. The fourth are patients more than 1 year after the initial diagnosis or after revascularization. The fifth scenario are patients with angina and suspected vasospastic or microvascular disease, which were called previously as syndrome X. The last scenarios are patients who are asymptomatic in whom coronary artery disease was detected at screening. The natural course of chronic coronary syndromes is interrupted by acute coronary syndromes, after which the patient comes back into a chronic coronary syndrome status. If these patients are not managed properly with suboptimal lifestyle modifications or medical therapy or optimal revascularization as indicated, these patients go to a worse course with more frequent acute coronary syndromes, as you see here in the red line. And if these patients are treated optimally regarding the risk factor control and medical optimal medical therapy and revascularization, if indicated, they will have a much better course. Lifestyle recommendations according to the European guidelines include smoking cessation using either pharmacologic or and behavioral strategies to help the patients to stop smoking, and avoiding passive smoking is an important part in cessation of smoking. Healthy diets are recommended with high vegetable, fruit, and whole grain intake, limitation of saturated fats to less than 10% of the total intake, and limitation of alcohol intake to less than 100 grams per week or 15 grams per day. Physical activity is recommended with 30 to 60 minutes moderate physical activity in most days, and if this is not feasible, any kind of irregular activity will be beneficial. Regarding healthy weight, obtaining and maintaining healthy body mass index of less than 25 is recommended through physical activity, through diet control, whatever. Also, compliance to medications is very important, and sexual activity in low-risk stable patients not symptomatic at low to moderate activity levels are allowed. When you look to smoking cessation, 5 A's are recommended. Ask about smoking. Don't forget to ask about smoking. Many physicians forget to ask. And then advise patients to quit, and then assess the readiness of the patients to quit. Not just advice, you have to assess the readiness to quit, and then assist the patient smoking for smoking cessation, whatever this, by psychological support or by pharmacological treatment, and then arrange follow-up for these patients. And these are the 5 A's recommended. Regarding the healthy diet, increase consumption of fruits and vegetables to more than or equal 200 grams each per day. And 35 to 45 grams of fiber per day are recommended, preferably whole grain. Moderate consumption of nuts. 1 to 2 servings of fish per week are recommended. Limited lean meat and low-fat dietary products and liquid vegetable oils. Saturated fats less than 10%, as I said before, and replace with polyunsaturated fats. A little intake of trans unsaturated fats is recommended. This should not be more than 1% of the total energy intake. Salt intake should not exceed 5 to 6 grams per day. And alcohol, as I mentioned before, and avoid energy dense foods such as sugar and sweetened soft drinks. The recommendations are class 1 recommendations for all patients to improve lifestyle by appropriate pharmacological management if needed, cognitive behavioral interventions, exercise-based cardiac rehabilitation is recommended, and involvement of multidisciplinary healthcare professionals should all be included in the management of the patients, cardiologists with nurses, dietitians, psychotherapists, psychiatrists, and pharmacists, all should be included. Psychological interventions are recommended, and annual influenza vaccination is also class 1 recommendation. Okay. What's new in the recent guidelines? There is a change in the treatment, pharmacologic treatment of chronic coronary syndromes. Trimetazidine now became class 2A, like nitrates, evabradine, and nicorandil in the new guidelines. Long-acting nitrates for second-line treatment after attempts of beta blockers and non-dihydropyridine are now recommended even before starting either nitrates, before evabradine, nicorandil, and ranolazine. And the combination of beta blockers and calcium channel blockers in the new guidelines are recommended as class 2B with second line therapy from the start. Combination of beta blockers, calcium channel with second line therapy as a first line measurement are recommended as class 2B. This algorithm shows 5 different scenarios. The standard therapy, beta blockers, calcium channel, second step, combine beta blockers with dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers like amlodipine, and third step, to add second line drugs. This is the recommendation for the guidelines. As we said, class 2B to start first step with second step together from beta blocker or calcium channel blockers with second line from the start. This is class 2B. If the patient has a high heart rate, and the example was given here as more than 80, it's an arbitrary number, beta blockers or non-dihydropyridine like diltiazem should be given, and then combine both at low doses to avoid hypotension and monitor heart rate. If this is not sufficient, then beta blockers are added to evabradine. Reminding you that non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers are contraindicated to be given with evabradine. If heart rate is low, dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers like amlodipine, then long-acting nitrates, and then combine both, and fourth step will be nicorandil and ranolazine. If LV dysfunction or heart failure is present, beta blockers, and then add beta blockers to long-acting nitrates or evabradine, and the third step to add another second-line drug. If patients have low blood pressure, so low-dose beta blockers with low-dose non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers, second step, evabradine, ranolazine, and trimetazidine, and combine to second-line therapy at third step. These are the classes of recommendation for what we said in the previous algorithm. I'm not going to repeat this again. Regarding the antithrombotic therapy, what's new in the new guidelines? The new guidelines allowed as a class 2A to add secondary antithrombotic drugs to aspirin for long-term secondary prevention in patients with high risk of ischemic events without high risk of bleeding, and this was a contraindication previously. Class 2B indication in patients with moderate risk. Okay, regarding NUACs, NUACs are recommended, this is new in the guidelines, to recommend NUACs over vitamin K antagonists if indicated in patients with atrial fibrillation, and long-term oral anticoagulants are recommended in patients with SHADS VAX score 2 or more in males, 3 or more in females as class 1 and class 2A if score 1 in males and 2 in females. Regarding post-PCI patients, full-dose NUACs are recommended in preference to vitamin K antagonists. This is a new recommendation. It's allowed to give suboptimal dosing for rivaroxaban, 15 milligrams, over despite of 20, and dabigatran, 110 despite of 150, but only for rivaroxaban and dabigatran. Apixaban, there is no dose reduction. Early cessation, less than 1 week of aspirin, sometimes is allowed in this guideline as class 2A. In patients with high risk of bleeding, and triple therapy for 1 to 6 months, class 2A, and INR adjustment for 2 to 2.5. Dual therapy with prasugrel and ticagrelor over clopidogrel, and this is new in the guidelines. PPI in patients receiving aspirin and the high risk of GIT bleeding is class 1 indication. Ezetimibe adding to statin, if not controlled, it's class 1 in these guidelines. PCSK9 inhibitors addition after this, if not controlled, is class 1 in these guidelines. Regarding treatment of diabetes in patients with chronic coronary syndromes, it is class 1 to start with SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP-1 analogs, as we said in the guidelines for diabetes. ACE inhibitors are recommended as class 2A in patients with very high risk of cardiovascular adverse events. Carotid ultrasonography for screening is for intermediate thickness now is class 3. If you are going to screen for the presence of plaques, not for intermediate to medial thickness. And then for refractory angina, we will discuss this later. Regarding the antithrombotic, as we said, aspirin recommended in patients with previous MI or revascularization as class 1. In the absence of these two indications, it is class 2B. It's not now routine for every patient. It is class 2B if in the absence of previous MI or revascularization. If patients with definite coronary artery disease, without these two indications, it is class 2B. Clopidogrel as an alternative to aspirin if it is contraindicated or intolerant. In patients with peripheral arterial disease or transient ischemic attack, clopidogrel may be preferred to aspirin at class 2B. Dual antiplatelet therapy may be considered class 2A in the absence of PCI. In patients at high risk of ischemic events without high risk of bleeding, and this is new, for secondary prevention, for moderate risk patients, this class 2B, as we said before. Now it's allowed to give ticagrelor 60 post-MI patients after 1 year, or prasugrel 10 milligrams to reduce to 5 with age more than 75 and body weight less than 60. Rivaroxaban is now recommended in a dose of 2.5 after 1 year of myocardial infarction in patients with multivessel disease. Post-PCI, the recommendation is 6 months of dual antiplatelet therapy, regardless of the type of the stent, and shorter durations from 1 to 3 months may be recommended as class 2A for 3 months in patients with high risk of life-threatening bleeding, and 1 month it's class 2B. Prasugrel or ticagrelor may be given alone without in placement of aspirin and clopidogrel in patients with suboptimal stent deployment, procedural characteristic associated with high risk of stent thrombosis, left main stem or multivessel stenting, if DAPT cannot be used because of aspirin intolerance. In this situation, you can use either prasugrel or ticagrelor. Patients with AF, as we said, NOACs are preferred, and CHA2DS2 VASC score 2 and 3, it's class 2A with CHA2DS2 VASC score 2 and 1. Patients with AF and history of acute myocardial infarction at high risk of recurrent ischemic events who do not have high bleeding risk, aspirin may be considered in addition to oral anticoagulation. This was discussed before. Okay. Now, this is what we said about reducing the dose in patients with high risk of bleeding in rivaroxaban and dabigatran. This is not recommended in apixaban. In uncomplicated PCI, early cessation less than 1 week of aspirin and the continuation of dual therapy with oral anticoagulants and clopidogrel should be considered if the risk of stent thrombosis is low or there is a concern of bleeding. This is class 2A. Triple therapy, aspirin, clopidogrel, and oral anticoagulants more than 1 month should be considered when there is a risk of stent thrombosis that overweighs the risk of bleeding. And in patients with an indication of vitamin K combination with aspirin or clopidogrel, the dose or intensity of vitamin K should be adjusted to INR from 2 to 25, to 2.5, as I said before. In patients with recommended antithrombotic therapy, post-PCI with AF, or there's another indication of oral anticoagulants, dual therapy with oral anticoagulants with either ticagrelor or prasugrel may be considered as an alternative to triple therapy of oral anticoagulants, aspirin, and clopidogrel in patients with moderate or high risk of stent thrombosis, irrespective of the type of the stent, and this is class 2B. Of course, the use of ticagrelor as a part of triple therapy is a contraindication, as you all know. Proton pump inhibitors, class 1 indications where there is a high risk of bleeding in association with DAPT or oral anticoagulation. Statins, start with the statins. If not controlled, go to ezetimibe addition. And then, if not controlled, add PCSK9 inhibitors. All are class 1 indications. ACE are recommended if there is another compelling indication like heart failure and hypertension or diabetes as class 1. In patients at very high risk of cardiovascular events, it is class 2A. Beta blockers with LED dysfunction or systolic heart failure, it's class 1. Patients with previous STEMI long-term beta blockers are class 2A. Diuretics should be recommended in patients with heart failure. Class 1 beta blockers, ACE, ARBs in place of ACE or naprilacin inhibitors, all are class 1. Mineralocorticoid antagonists are considered as class 1 indication. Short-acting or transcutaneous nitrates to relieve angina, class 2A indication. Evabradine, class 2A indication if heart rate more than 70 and ejection fraction less than 35 or equals 35. Amlodipine for relief of angina in patients with heart failure who do not tolerate beta blockers, it is class 2B. Regarding the devices, patients with bradycardia or high degree AV block, pacing is recommended to be with CRT rather than right ventricular pacing. The indications of CRT, as you know, QRS duration more or equal than 150, as you see here, with left bundle branch block, class 1, level of evidence A, with 130 to 149, it's class 1 level of evidence is B, it's less level of evidence. regarding myocardial revascularization, I think this is the issue in the next lecture. Regarding the implantable cardioversor defibrillators, the indications are patients with documented ventricular life-threatening ventricular arrhythmia or patients with symptomatic heart failure with ejection fraction of 35 or less to reduce the risk of sudden death. Regarding blood pressure management, starting treatment the same as mentioned in the general population and the hypertension guidelines. Regarding diabetes, as we said, risk factor control start with SGLT2 inhibitors, SGLT2 inhibitors or GLP-1 analogs as class 1 recommendation. ACE inhibitors recommended in diabetic patients for event reduction as class 1 recommendation. In asymptomatic patients with diabetes, functional imaging or coronary CT may be considered for advanced cardiovascular risk assessment as class 2B indication. It is recommended that the risk factors are controlled to target values. Recommend special attention to potential dose adjustment in patients with renal disease and to use ionized contrast if patients with chronic kidney disease are going to have intervention. In elderly patients, DAS are recommended as class 1 indication. Be cautious regarding the side effects of the drugs. Radial access is recommended, and the decisions should be based on symptoms, extent of ischemia, frailty, and life expectancy, and comorbidities as class 1. Thank you. I need just 2 slides. Hormone replacement therapy is class 3 indication. Regarding refractory angina, enhanced external counterpulsation, it's class 2B. Reducer device for coronary sinus constriction, this is an hourglass device that's implanted in the coronary sinus to reduce angina in patients with refractory angina, it's class 2B. Spinal cord stimulation is class 2B in the guidelines. Now, transmyocardial revascularization is class 3 for management of these patients with refractory angina. For further details are present in the full text in the site of the European Society of Cardiology, and there is a pocket guidelines that can summarize these guidelines. Thank you.